Thanks to also to you and to the other organizers for these days. And during my talk, I will indeed speak about some phase transitions. So, and even double phase transitions. By double, you can think ice becomes water, becomes gas. There is a double phase transition of composition schemes in combinatorics, and what are the corresponding limit laws. So it's a joint work with these two nice fellows, Markus Kuba and Michel Wallner from Wien. Okay, so introduction. So in combinatorics, we study a lot of different combinatorial structures. We want to enumerate them to get asymptotic properties of them and so on. And by combinatorial structures, I mean quite often an assemblage of basic building blocks, for example, random walks, set of steps. Polya urns could be seen also as set of building blocks. A tree will be a sequence of subtrees. So Galton-Watson processes could be seen also like this. Permutations, they are a set of cycles. Random mappings, set partitions, integer partitions, even tilings. But tilings in a discrete way, for example, if you tiles by domino, which could be horizontally or vertically, you have a sequence of guys which are horizontal or vertical, and you get the Fibonacci numbers, this type of tilings. Graphs, maps, all of them could be seen as some kind of mixture of manipulation of basic building blocks, a little bit with the type of operations that we saw this morning in the talk by Nicolas. And the type of constructions that I will consider are compositions in the sense of composition of function. Oops, we have a composition here. Multiplied by something else after, okay, to get more generality. And the composition is called critical if, when you increase z, z will become a singularity of h, and h of z will become a singularity of g at the same time. Okay. And additionally, you may or not have this critical value of z. The radius of convergence could be this one for the factorial. Okay, so example of such compositions, for example, we will detail more later, but bicolored supertrees, which are expressed like this, where this is a generating function of Catalan numbers. Or if you consider walks, you have a sequence of some type of primitive arches times some meanders, some stuff at the end, and it's also of the same scheme as above. So if you want thousands of examples of this, you can have a look in the nice book by Flageolet and Sedgwick, Analytic Combinatorics, which is explaining in which way to derive the generating functions, in which way to use complex analysis to get the asymptotics, and this is what we will do in this talk. And sometimes you have also some more probabilistic point of view. For example, this is the case in this book, which is more or less focusing on the case where, let's say, G is a logarithm. Yeah. And it's possible to handle this with random variables and so on. Okay, so a more pictorial view of what could be combinatorial structures and which could be expressed as compositions. So you have here different types of trees, labeled increasing trees or super trees, trees of trees, some lattice paths, some polyhedron process. You have a number of black and white balls, and you have some rules of evolution. I will give more examples, more details on these examples later. The Chinese restaurant problem, maps, planar maps. You could have some type of core, and you can substitute faces or edges by some other stuff, and then you get more general maps. So all of this could be encoded by the critical schemes that we saw before. Okay, so what we want to do more precisely? We want to follow, for example, the number of basic building blocks, the edge structures, the number of edge structures when we have such a composition scheme. So the variable z will mark the number, the size, the number of atoms in your structure, and the exponent of the variable u, k here, will say, oh, I have k structures of type H. And if you give me now a structure at random of size n, what is the probability that it has k structures h, k blocks h? It's sometimes also called the size of the core. Okay, so we want to follow this probability, the distribution of this guy. So in many, many cases, the generating function of h here will behave at its radius of convergence like this. And you have a kind of Puiseux series expansion. For example, it could behave like a square root, and therefore it will be the cage lambda h equals 1 over half. Okay. And we will see that this probability, the asymptotic behavior of this quantity, depends strongly on this singular exponent here, sometimes also called critical exponent. So, in fact, you have different worlds depending on in which range of value is h. So if h is negative, then you don't have a critical scheme and you get some asymptotics, and the analysis is easy. It is called the supercritical case. It's typically, at the end, a Gaussian limit law. In this talk, I will focus on the range lambda h between 0 and 1. And we will see that it leads to a family of special functions, which are called general Mittag-Leffler distribution, and a special case of heat, for example, when lambda h equals 1 half, and when the factor m is exactly 1, it gives you the Rayleigh distribution. And you have a full set of models in combinatorics which leads to this Rayleigh distribution. I can comment also briefly on the range between 1 and 2. So in fact, this was analyzed in some old work of me, Philippe Lajollet, Michel Soria, and Gilles Schaeffer. And interesting subcase of this range is this value, which leads to the world of the Airy function on what we call the map Airy distribution that can be analyzed at the same time, either with some coalescing saddle point approach or by singularity analysis, which will be the point of view that I will develop more here later. Okay, and whenever the critical exponent of h is larger than 2, then you get a Gaussian limit law. So the two interesting ranges are here and here. This was done in this article, and now we do this. Okay, and not only it is possible to analyze the number of structures, of h structures in your big stuff, the number of blocks, but you can also ask more precise questions. You can refine your question and ask how many blocks of size j you have in your big structure. So, and this is exactly what is done here. Here, this is the generating function of all the different types of blocks. I will remove the guys of size j, and I re-add them by marking them with the variable v. Therefore, I will get a bivariate generating function in which I have my big structures with exponent of z will be still the number of atoms, but the variable v will count the number of structures of size structure h of size exactly j. Okay, and the same question: what is the distribution of this quantity? It's sometimes called the profile of your object. You want to follow this. And for sure, if you sum for all the different values of j, you get back to the previous random variable. Okay, and we will see that this problem mostly lead to what is called a mixed Poisson distribution. Okay, so let's see a little bit how it may look. So this is our scheme, the classical composition scheme. We restrict to the exponent h between 0 and 1. Okay, so we are counting objects, so all the coefficients of generating functions, they are non-negative integers and so on. And so what you get, in fact, you have some double phase transition. So depending on the relationship between the critical exponent of h, g, and m, then you have three different types of limit laws. So in the case where this exponent is larger than the product of these two guys, you get a Mittag-Leffler distribution. I will explain later in detail what is Mittag-Leffler and so on. But just now. In this case, you get a mixture linear combination of a Mittag-Leffler and a Boltzmann distribution. And in this case, you just get a discrete limit law, which is a Boltzmann distribution. Okay, so this is for the distribution of the number of blocks. Now, if you refine to follow exactly the blocks of a given size, J, here you have another phase transition. So you have this value here, which is lambda h, 1 plus lambda h, which will be the main critical exponent, which will appear for all these problems. It will be universal. And below this window, you will get a general Mittag-Leffler distribution. At exactly the window, you will get a mixed Poisson related to this Mittag-Leffler distribution. I will explain later what exactly it means, but you can see that it is a kind of mixture between a discrete and the shape of a Mittag-Leffler. So it's kind of mixed Poisson of this. And if you are above the critical window, then you get just a discrete distribution, a direct distribution. Okay, alors, example a little bit more in detail with bicolored supertrees. So if you consider plane trees, I have one root, and to each node I can attach any number of children, and the order is important. I cannot permute the subtrees, it won't be the same trees. Okay, so obviously it is counted by this. I have my root, and I have attaching to it a sequence of subtrees, and the in which the order is important. Okay, so it's an equation of degree 2. If you solve it, you get this guy. Okay. Now. Okay. Now, if in your big plane trees, you replace each node by a tree, by a root, which is blue or red, to which you attach a tree. So in each patatoid, you substitute a tree. So you get a new structure, which is counted by this. And this is exactly what is called bicolored supertrees. They are trees of trees. And you can check that if you increase Z, this guy becomes singular at the same time as this guy is singular. Okay. And if we apply the previous theorem, we get that, okay, the number of big patatoids in such a structure of size n will have some moments which are given, factorial moments which are given by a product of gamma function. Okay. And if you do this following renormalization, you will converge in distribution, and all moments also will converge to this Mittag-Leffler distribution, which is characterized by these two quantities, which are in fact related to the lambda h. Okay, and you additionally, you have a local limit theorem, so a more precise description of what happens around this value. Okay, and now if you refine to the size, so now you have your super tree, and you want to follow the number of patatoids of size j. Okay, so this is the scheme. Then you will get that the number of patatoids of size j, the moments of heat, are given by this formula. Okay, so, so it's mixed Poisson distribution, so related mixing this Mittag-Leffler, the moments of this Mittag-Leffler again given by a product of gamma function, and you have all the kind of double phase transitions that I mentioned before, where I had the critical window, so by the double phase transition, I mean, oops, yes, this one. In this window, you get the mixed Poisson. Before, it will be Mittag-Leffler. After, it will be discrete. So this is
if you have one peak, you don't have the distribution.
You could, it depends in which sense. For Dirac, yes, but. So the I went too far, no? No, okay, this is what we add. And this you can also do it for a lot of other structures. For example, you can follow the number of descendants of nodes of some degrees in increasing trees. You can consider the block sizes in a variant of Stirling permutations. Sopping times in urns, the number of inversions, so labels which will be in different orders in label trees. The number of ancestors, descendants in some variant of K-trees. You can follow the number of sign changes or the number of returns to zeros where you consider a lattice path. The size of the table in Chinese restaurant processes. And some stuff related to polya urns. So we will zoom later on some more on this problem. Okay, but let's explain a little bit more what were the strange distributions that I mentioned. They are at the same time standard, but some of them are new and perhaps not that well known. Alors, something which is very well known, this is the stable law, or stable law of parameter alpha. So more generally, you could have another parameters attached to stable laws, but in combinatorics, you can just focus to this main parameter, alpha. Okay, and this is, so you say that a random variable follows a stable law of parameter alpha if the generating function of the moments are given by this function, or equivalently, the density has this expression. Okay, and here for sure, you use the convention that 1 over plus infinity is 0. Hein. If this guy is 0, 1 over 0, for negative values of gamma, you will have 1 over infinity. Okay, and now, what is the Mittag-Leffler distribution? You can see it as the power 1 minus alpha of a stable law. It's one possible definition. Okay, and why it was called Mittag-Leffler distribution? Because if you consider the moment generating function of such a distribution, then you get exactly the historical Mittag-Leffler function, which is this one. Okay, and then you can play a little bit with some more parameters and so on, and then you get that the moment of what is called the generalized Mittag-Leffler distribution is given by this expression. So, in particular, you recognize, it is encoding the half-normal distribution, the Rayleigh distribution, the classical Mittag-Leffler distribution, and so on. So, and one more distribution which appears in work is the beta Mittag-Leffler distribution, which is exactly this distribution. So you have the power of a beta distribution here, times Mittag-Leffler, and the parameters are linked. And this is what we prove to be a new universal limit law, which will appear for all these problems and so on. And here also, the moments of such distributions is given by a product of gamma function, and you have some nice identities. And so it is in the family of gamma type distribution, which was analyzed in a big survey by Svat Jansson. And you can also express its density by integrals or in hypergeometric functions. So you can give explicit form for the moment, but also for the density. Okay. So in which way we use this and we do the proof? So it's a little bit related to the moment problem. So what we have is that our random variables, the number of blocks, will converge to, for example, such distribution with gamma type. And in fact, all our distributions, they will be characterized by their moments. The moments are given here. Alors, in which way it is working? Well, you have this theorem by Fréchet and Shoah that if you have a sequence of moments which tends to some moments which are finite, like this, then the distribution at a finite size n will converge to the limit. The limiting distribution corresponding to the MR. And for sure, it works if the moments MR determines uniquely a distribution X. And when is it the case? Then you have those theorems by Kalman and so on. So, and for this, you need to consider the support of the distribution. It will play a role. And so you have some criterion. So if the support of the distribution is on 0 plus infinity, this is called the Stieltjes moment problem, then you just have to check that the sum of this power of the moments is diverging. So you can check with this, and you will see it diverge. So therefore, there is only one distribution which has those moments, and it will be the one that we gave before. And you have some similar conditions, with just a little twist here on the index. There is no typo, it's really this formula, if the support is different. And you have also some conditions if the support is bounded, and it's called the Hausdorff moment problem. And for this problem, there will be more on this in the talk by Carol. Okay. Something that we are using also, to compute the moments, there is something which appears to be useful in our work, which is the notion of to tilt a density. So tilted densities, or moment shift. So if you have a random variable for which you know the sequence of moments, okay, and the density, you can consider the tilt of the density, which is by a polynomial factor. So this is, we tilt it by multiplying by this quantity, so it's still a density, okay. And you can prove that if you do this, you get a new density, and the moments of this density will be just a shift of the moments of the original function. And also, the moment-generating function, it's possible to relate the moment-generating function of the tilted random variable to the moment-generating function of the original random variable. Okay, and here for sure you have to have a kind of fractional calculus definition of this if you want to make sense of this when it is not an integer. Okay, and additionally you have some nice properties of this type. The tilt of Mittag-Leffler classical one, it's exactly generalized Mittag-Leffler. So whenever you hear the word generalized Mittag-Leffler with two parameters, you can, oh, okay, just a classical Mittag-Leffler in which I do this tilt on the density. Okay, and then you have also some properties for stable laws and so on. And, okay, so one more stuff, still two more distributions to define. So the notion of mixed Poisson distribution. So it was first introduced for actuarial mathematics in chance modeling by Duburgo many years ago. It was studied by Lundberg under another name, which means something completely different nowadays. It was used for different models. And you have a lot of works studying the unimodal properties of them, the tail asymptotics, and so on. And what is the formal definition of a mixed Poisson distribution? Okay, so it is here. So you start with a given random variable, which is non-negative, for which you know the cumulative distribution function. And then you create this integral, okay, and it will give the probability of this new random variable. It's defined by this. And then it will be said that y is following a mixed Poisson distribution with parameter x or with parameter u. It's just a matter of language. Okay. So it becomes something which is discrete. And as we saw a few slides ago, you have a kind of, let's say, discrete interpolation in one sense of the continuous distribution. And one important property of mixed Poisson distribution is that it's very easy to compute their factorial moments. You see, if you know the moments of this guy, then the moments of the mixed Poisson distribution corresponding, just multiplication by this. Okay. So now we define all the zoo of probability distribution that we needed, almost, I think. And we can comment a little bit more on what happens. So in fact, when we have a critical scheme like this, there will be, in the proof, there will be a lot of different subcases to consider, which will depend in which way when you multiply the PSE expansion, they will interfere or not. And therefore, you have all those conditions, which are in fact summarized by this picture. So the on this line here, you have equality between these quantities, and it will be called the confluent case. There's a kind of all the factors play a role. In this case, in one sense, only M will play a role, and it is simpler. And in this case, only G of H will play a role. And, and depending on those relationships between this critical exponent, we get the different distribution. So for example, when the scheme is pure, then we get the beta-Mittag-Leffler distribution, which we defined before. Yes, and here I wanted an image of something pure, so just before of the talk of Richard, I decided to have a diamond, so this is a pure scheme. And okay, we have everything. In this case, we have the moment, the density, and so on. And for some values, it simplifies. For example, this case is covering the relay, the half-normal distribution, and so on. And if G is, the exponent of G is minus one, then it is exactly something which is happening quite often when you have a sequence of in combinatorics. And so it's covered by this also. Okay, so you have this degenerate case where lambda m, the critical exponent of m, is smaller than what is there. Okay, and then you get a Boltzmann distribution. Alors, this is the only one which I did not define yet. So what is a Boltzmann distribution? So it's a kind of Gibbs measure on some combinatorial objects, in one sense. The probability of an object of size n, or that a random variable has a value n, will be given by the coefficient gn of your generating function times x to the n divided by g to the x. So it's parameterized by the value of x. So here, quite often when for people who play with generating functions, x is it's a formal power series, we don't give a value to x. But here in Boltzmann, suddenly you decide to give a value to x, so it has to be in the radius of convergence of the generating function, and then everything is well defined, and you define those distributions. And what is quite nice is that those distributions, they play a key role for uniform random generation. So it was something which was developed by Flageolet, Duchon, Luchard, and Schaeffer some years ago. And it allows to generate, let's say, in linear time, up to some threshold, the objects of size n. And this was a big revolution, because before other methods, which were recursive and so on, they were costing, let's say, n square time. And this gives a linear time algorithm. So it was suddenly possible to generate, instead of generating objects of size, let's say, a few hundreds, to generate objects of size 1,000. So it was really a big revolution. And the idea was just to give a value, to use this. And then there is a miracle that when you do the Cartesian product of some stuff, to compute the probability of the product is just one product and not the Cauchy product, which will be linear time. And so. Okay, so this is the distribution that we get in this case, Boltzmann distribution. And in the confluent case, so when there is a kind of really interplay between the critical exponent of m and the critical exponent of lambda g lambda h, then what we get, it's a funny phenomenon, we get a convex combination of a distribution here, which is the Boltzmann distribution, with something which is a Mittag-Leffler distribution. So you have a linear combination between a discrete and continuous with some parameters here multiplied by a Bernoulli, which have parameters, which I think, so for sure we get this with analytic computations. I have no idea at all in which way it could be possible to explain this via probability theory. Maybe it is, but not obvious to get those quantities. Okay, and this is explaining curve like this. In red, you have the Boltzmann. In blue, you have the Mittag-Leffler. and the behavior that we have is the sum of the two at the end. Okay, so, and we get some phase transitions, which are of this type. Okay, let's go on. The refined scheme works also, we get this, and here I want to comment on something, which is that, okay, we have this window, okay, and now we define what was exactly the beta metagliffler, the mixed Poisson of beta metagliffler, so all of this was defined. And so for sure it's possible to give kind of physical interpretations of what it means to have this or this. It means that we have, in this case, when n is large, we have many small, by small, it means some blocks, some patatoids of size less than this, some giant, which means this, and no supergiant stuff like this. Dirac here is there. And something which is also quite important, there are really many problems in combinatorics, in mathematics, for which you have some phase transitions which are involving a window of size 1 over third. It appears quite often also with the Airy function and so on, but 1 over third. And here, it's possible not to explain why. This 1 over third is in fact just the trace of this guy in which you plug lambda h equals 1 over half. And why lambda h equals 1 over half is often the case in combinatorics? Because you have many structures which are defined by some strongly connected system of equations. And as soon as you have some structures which are defined by a strongly connected system of equations, all the functions depend on the others, then it's possible to prove that you have a square root singularity. So square root singularity is ubiquitous in combinatorics. Therefore, lambda h equals 1 half is ubiquitous. And therefore, phase transitions with window of this size are ubiquitous. Okay, so a few applications. This is a different example that we had in the article, and I will zoom on some of them. For example, if we consider return to zeros in some walks with drift. So we have a walks on the z-square lattice, directed lattice path. We have a set of vectors which are given, which are directed, which goes to the right. And the different possible jumps that you can do are given by the quantity SI here. Okay, so you have the step polynomial, which are given by P of U. And the drift will be the value P prime of 1. It will say if the walks has a tendency to go up, down, or to stay at the same altitude. So the drift 0 is more interesting, quite often. So we are in this case. And in this case, when you have a walk, you can decompose it into a sequence of returns to zero. And then something at the end, which is, it is crossing the axis, but it is not stopping at the axis. You see here, they are not returns to zero. You go from, I don't know, minus 1 to plus 1, stuff like this. So here, there are no returns to zero in this part. Okay, so you have this factorization, you can write it, and you get at the end that the generating function of such guys, where u will mark the number of returns to zero, will be of this type. So it's exactly the type of composition scheme that we had before. Okay, so you can apply the theorem, and you can even refine it by marking the blocks of size exactly j. So you will mark the number of distant j zeros, which will mean that you will mark here, enfin you can mark, the number of factors of size j. And if you do this, you just apply the previous theorem, and then you get, okay, that it is converging to a mixed Poisson distribution, and that if you consider walks, means ending anywhere, or walks ending exactly at zero, they are called bridges, you get in fact different distributions, Rayleigh or half normal. And this is just application of what we had before, and the phase transition with this n over 1 over 3. Okay. So you could do some variant also by coloring walks 0.3, just a variant of previous ideas. I will skip this one. You can follow also the number of sign changes. For example, so here you have some Motzkin walks. So Motzkin walks, you have just jumps minus one, zero, plus one. Okay, and a sign changes will be when you go from negative to positive or positive to negative. Okay, so the so in this case, you have in this example. Okay, and you can follow the number of factors of size j. Okay, and okay here also you get half normal, relay, and the different regime with phase transitions, 1/3. Okay. Another model, which is the Chinese restaurant process, which was studied by Aldous, Bittman, Yor, and many other people. So this is a process on which you they are indexed by set partitions. Okay, so you start with the partition which is just one. You have one. Okay, and then at each unit of time, what you will have, you will add n plus one to some of the tables with this probability, and you can for sure you can open tables and so on. So you have this probability, and you see that it is parameterized by some quantities alpha and theta. And so this is in fact some model which has also a rich combinatorics behind it. So it's possible to associate some plane-oriented recursive trees to this. Okay. And so the number of tables with j customers will be the number of branches of size j in this model. And you can here also apply the same theorem that we had. So you have to follow a little bit what will be the critical exponent. You can get them in terms of this alpha and theta, which was parameter of the Chinese restaurant process. And you will get convergence, Suchras, Mittag-Leffler distribution, in distribution, all moments, depending also on if you are below the transition window, at the transition window, or after. Okay, Polya-Hearns, last example, I think. So Polya-Hearns, this is a process in which you have some balls of different colors in some urns, white and black, for example, and at each unit of time, you pick one ball, you look at its color, you put it back inside, and if its color was black, then you add alpha black balls, beta white balls. If the color of the ball was white, then you add delta white balls. Okay, so you have something, a replacement matrix here. In this replacement matrix, if you ask that the sum by line is the same, it's called a balanced Hearns, and if you have zeros here, it's a triangular Hearns. So here we consider balanced triangular Polya Hearns. Okay, and you are asking after n iteration of the process, this is a different possible evolution of the process with the multiplicities, the histories, you are asking what is the probability that after n time I have n balls of color black. And so on. Okay. So this model was analyzed by Svante Jansson and other people. You have also some work by Philippe Flageolet, Philippe Dumas, and Vincent Puy-Aubert. And it's possible to prove that the generating function of the number of histories is given by this scheme. And I don't know if you see it, but it is a composition scheme in the sense that we had before. We have here some function f, which is some factor m times something which is a function g of h. Okay, so you just apply the previous theorem, and you get that. Oops, sorry. And you get that you converge to the beta Mittag-Leffler distribution, all the different also transition windows and so on. So the and for this model, some people were able also to rederive this also with tools from more probability theory. So Christina Goldschmidt, Benedict Haas, and Delphine Saint-Nizier also worked on this. Okay. So more generally, it's possible to consider different schemes. So any combinatorial structures which will be computed by, okay, this we saw, but also you could put some log here, so it's not exactly critical in the sense that we defined, so, but it's a generalization of what we did, it will work also. You could have several variables, you could have some several variables and to refine the size of the different variables, and in all the cases, you get the variant of Mittag-Leffler distribution or mixed Poisson involving Mittag-Leffler distribution that we had. And this is giving the explanation of why, for all those models, there was some phase transitions which we know we can systematically locate at this value. And this explains the universality of this 1/3 transition phase, which are occurring in so many combinatorial structures. And I can end with a critical composition of things of things.
Thank you, dear Cyril. Some time for questions because we have five minutes shift.
Yes, question and comment. First comment. Mittag-Leffler functions is usually used very often in relaxation theory because it's all Mittag-Leffler function is related, pure Mittag-Leffler function, we call it one parametric Mittag-Leffler function, it's related with Cole-Cole relaxation.
With what, sorry?
Cole-Cole relaxation.
Alors,
Cole-Cole, C-O-L okay. Minus C-O-L.
Okay.
Yes, and it's related and it's quite well known.
Not by me, at least.
Not by you. No, it was very interesting, though.
I just go back to where is the Mittag-Leffler function, just to check if indeed it was exactly the same one.
No. You were talking about, call it for us, two parameters Mittag-Leffler functions.
Yes, after there is a generalization.
And, okay. And in the relaxation theory, there also exists three parameters.
Ah, okay.
And because we are not using two, we are using three. Can you repeat it?
And is it the case that the second parameter, which is used here for the generalization of the Mittag-Leffler function,
not for relaxation, but here, no.
So the classical Mittag-Leffler is there.
Exponential.
No. When you have the definition via the series.
Okay, stable law, okay, yes.
Down. Yeah, instead of one in gamma function, you have beta.
Okay.
And these two parameters, called by you generalized Mittag-Leffler functions, and it is the eigenfunction of the fractional calculus in Caputo sense.
I am not sure. Okay, so quite often special functions they admit a lot of generalization. So the question will be: is it the case that when you put a beta here,
you obtain
those moments? Okay, this okay, I was not sure. Okay, yeah.
But in relaxation theory, we are using the three parameters.
One more parameter, yes.
One more parameter.
Oh, so then it could be
related with.
We had one here. So okay, the question will be: it will be a miracle if the third parameter will be indeed related to this one.
Yes, can you repeat it for large parameter?
So with three parameters, it's here. The moments are given by here. So if you can match the moments that you add, then it will be funny because then the beta Mittag-Leffler distribution that we had will be exactly the same generalization that you are mentioning.
I will check if yes, but it would be very nice.
Can you repeat the keyword that you gave?
Cole-Cole relaxation, Habermas-Nagami relaxation, and Yurlevich-Veron-Stanislavski.
Okay, very difficult times. Okay, yes. Okay. Uh-huh. Oh, and by the way, because Kasia is there. So a part of the steps that I mentioned here, so for example here on the stable distribution, so I said that in combinatorics there are just this parameter, but here also it's possible to have more parameters for stable laws, and then you can play the game when alpha is rational to express this in terms of hypergeometric functions, and this is something which was considered by Carol Penson and Kasia in some article. Okay.
Other questions, remarks, or comments? Yes,
Is there a connection with the Zolotarev identities?
Alors, I think that yes, but this will be not at this level because Zolotarev will be a duality between what happens between 0 and 1 and 1 and 2. And indeed, there is a trace of this. Some of the expressions which are given here for the stable distributions, okay. When we play with other parameters between 1 and 2, you get formulas which are, in one sense, dual of those ones. So this is Zolotarev duality. And it is true that we have another article in progress in which we analyze in more details between 1 and 2, and there is a trace of this. So I am not able to derive those results via some Zolotarev identities, but it's just that you have some kind of similar phenomenon.
So this means for alpha between 1 and 2.
And for alpha between 1 and 2, in fact, the support is no more on 0 infinity, but on minus infinity plus infinity.
So we thank the speaker again.